Good morning, everybody. I'm Gaurav Gupta. So I'll be delivering a lecture in biotechnology subject. The topic which we're going to discuss today is animal cell culture. Animal cell culture is a very important technique which is going on these days. The culturing of cells is very important for a lot of purposes. So let's start with the basics of animal cell culture. The first of all, we'll discuss about cell. Before going to discuss how it can be cultured, we should be aware about what a cell is, what we can know about a cell. So cell is basically, it is regarded as a fundamental unit of life. Fundamental unit of life. So all life, all organisms, their body consists of one or more cells, means the organisms can be unicellular or they can be multicellular. Secondly, a cell is considered as a basic and the smallest unit of life, means it is something which is living. A typical cell, as we know, is the smallest structure which we can regard as living. So a cell primarily of two types. Cells can be categorized primarily into two types, a prokaryotic cell and a eukaryotic cell. So talking about prokaryotic cells generally, they can be distinguished from the other type, that is the eukaryotic cells, in the presence and absence of what we call as a nucleus. As we know, every cell has genetic material, which is mostly DNA. So this DNA, whether it is, how is it present inside a cell? Whether it is present as bound by a membrane or without a membrane. So prokaryotic cells do not have a membrane bound nucleus or a membrane bound genetic material, whereas the eukaryotic cells, the genetic material is bound within a well prominent membrane structure. So talking about other aspects of how a prokaryotic cell differs from that of a eukaryotic cell, a prokaryotic cell is a quite a simple structure, simple in structure as well as function. The structure of the cell is quite simple as well as the function. So as we see, the cell, a prokaryotic cell, if we can draw the structure, a prokaryotic cell is a simple cell structure marked by the presence of a cell wall, and then we have a cell membrane, then the cytoplasm, DNA or the genetic material is present as naked in the cytoplasm called nucleoid. Then we have small structures known as ribosomes. We might have something known as plasmid. Then it again, then the structures, the locomotory structures are present on the surface known as cilia or flagella. So talking about the prokaryotic cell, the structure is marked by these organelles. First and the foremost, the membrane bound organelles are absent. The DNA or the genetic material is present in the form of naked without a membrane. The cell wall is present, which is primarily made up of peptidoglycan or LPS, depending upon the type of organism. Then we have a cell membrane, which is an important structure. The plasmid provides extra benefits to the cell, which the host cell, for like the antibiotic resistance. Then we have a cytoplasm, the cilia and flagella for locomotory structures, ribosomes as protein factories. Then we have something called as mesosome. These mesosomes are the hubs where respiratory enzymes are trapped, and most of the metabolic activities are carried out in these structures. So very simple structure, no membrane bound organelles, very simple cell structure. Most organisms, all prokaryotes are unicellular, means they exist as single cell structures. They do not occur as a multicellular structure. Eukaryotes, on the other hand, if we talk about eukaryotic cell structure, so eukaryotes, we have two type of eukaryotic structures. We have plant cells and we have animal cells. Primarily, these two type of eukaryotic cells are present. Talking about plant cells, they are marked by the presence of a cell wall, then a membrane, cytoplasm, then a membrane bound nucleus, a large vacuole, then ribosome, mitochondria, chloroplast, then ribosomes are also there. Then we have something called as endoplasmic reticulum, small Golgi bodies. So the important thing about the plant cell is that the presence of a cell wall. The cell wall is an important structure. Cell wall enables the cell, it provides rigidity and structural stiffness to the cell. Membrane is, again, as you know, it is very important structure. Dynamic structures allow the transport of substances in and out of the cell. Then followed by, we have nucleus, we have mitochondria, we have endoplasmic reticulum, we have Golgi bodies. These are all membrane bound organelles, which are the characteristics of a eukaryotic cell, plus the nucleus which is present, or the DNA, a genetic material which is present. It is bound by a double membraned structure, a nuclear membrane. Animal cell differs from the plant cell in having, it lacks a cell wall. The nucleus is very prominent in the center, no large vacuole is present. There is no large vacuole in animal cells. Apart from that, there are mitochondria, there are endoplasmic reticulum, there are ribosomes, cytoplasm is there. So plasma membrane is there, cytoplasm is there, nucleus is there, endoplasmic reticulum is there, mitochondria is there. Then you have something very special structures called lysosomes. So as you can see, the difference between a plant cell and animal cell lies that plant cells have a cell wall, animal cell does not have a cell wall. Apart from that, there are specific organelles which are specific to both animal cell as well as plant cells. Animal cells possess lysosomes and they have centrioles, as compared to plant cells which have chloroplasts, which are specific to only plant cells. Animal cells lack chloroplasts and they do not have any chloroplast because they lack photosynthesis. So now, comparing these two cells, when we talk about, in broad sense, when we talk about animal cell culture is a technique in which you culture animal cells. So animals usually, and one important aspect about these plants and animals, are multicellular. Most of these are multicellular. So multicellular, being multicellular, it is difficult as compared to prokaryotic cell culture. When you need to culture prokaryotic cells like bacteria, they are much simpler, requires less expertise, less complex ingredients to work with, as compared to when you want to culture these plants and animal cells, because these cells generally occur as multicellular structures and it is difficult to get them in single cell suspension and then cultivate those cells in artificial conditions. Comparatively easy bacterial cell culture still requires a lot of expertise, as compared to animal cell culture requires less expertise. Animal cell culture being more complex, more tedious, more skill oriented, the person need to be very skilled when we talk about plant and animal cell culture. My lecture will be focusing on how we can culture animal cells in vitro using artificial conditions, using artificial media, using all sort of conditions we can monitor, we can regulate, and thus after that we are able to cultivate these cells. So cell culture, little introduction about it. It's a general strategy which we employ in lab conditions to get the cells out of an animal tissue. So, focusing on animal cell culture, the cell culture, it focuses on getting the tissue out. The tissue is then, which is multicellular structure, it is again a multicellular structure. We need to defragment it using chemical treatments, and then we obtain cells, and then we try to culture these cells, we try to grow these cells on artificial media. The cells are used to growing in vivo conditions, but the cell culture techniques or tissue culture, as may some may call it, these aim to get these cells out of in vivo conditions and then grow them on artificial substratums, artificial conditions. So, why do we need cell culture? So, this, as I told you, this technique is skill oriented, it's a very costly technique. So, why do we need it? First of all, there are a lot of things which we can achieve by culturing animal cells in vitro. For example, we can use them as model systems. Now, this is very important. When a lab is trying to standardize a chemical substance against any disease, any disorder, so they need to test it on something. So, initial testing, you cannot go directly to the animals or the human testing, because they pose, the chemical may pose a lot of risks. So, for initial testing purposes, these cell lines derived from various body tissues, we can have cell lines from almost all tissues. So, these act as model systems which we can use to study basic cell biology and interaction between how disease causing agents and how cells are reacting, and then how the different chemicals, different drugs, how they affect those cells in the initial stages. So, again, toxicity testing is whether a drug which is showing good results or which is having the potential to be a very good drug, whether it is toxic. So, we can do toxicity testing using various cell lines. And then cancer research, again a very important and very, very much useful area, that is the cancer research. We can use cancer cell lines. Cancer cell lines can be used to study the effect of how we can inhibit the growth of various cancer cells using chemicals, using small molecules, using viruses, using radiations. You can use variety of agents to see whether they can actually have an anti-cancer effect or not. Apart from that, virology is a field in which cell lines can be used. As you know, viruses are something which we describe as living chemicals. They need a host to replicate and proliferate. So, these cell lines can be used to harbor engineered viruses for vaccine production and to see normal, to see infectious cycles in case of normal viruses, how they proliferate and how we can control their proliferation. Next, animal cell culture is very useful in the techniques such as genetic engineering. Genetic engineering is a very important and very good technique which we can use for obtaining products of commercial value. For example, we can use it in vaccine production against rabies, chickenpox, hepatitis. So we are virtually using cells as bioreactors for getting the products of our desired use. Another such use is gene therapy. Now, this is a very current and very famous technique. So, gene therapy, it involves a disease in which a functional gene is not working properly in the body. So, we try and replace that non-functional gene with a correct gene or with a normal gene. So, cell lines can be the initial mode by which we can place the corrected gene into the cells. So these cell lines are which basically we get the cells out of the body. So tissue, we get the cells out from the tissue. We get the cells out. We replace the corrected gene. We introduce the corrected gene into these cells. Then these cells which have been corrected are again introduced back into the body. So this is gene therapy. The functional gene which is now introduced into the body is now able to correct the flaw, the disorder which was earlier present. So by using cell lines, by using animal cell culture techniques, we are able to find cure to diseases which were earlier considered to be uncurable. So stem cells, again a very important and very current topic, that is the stem cells. Stem cells are very important in the sense that these are proving to be very helpful in current medical scenario. These cells are very useful for curing those diseases which like spinal cord injuries, brain injuries, bone marrow transplant. So these cells have a potential to differentiate into any possible cell type. So if we are able to isolate stem cells and grow them in lab conditions, so by using optimum conditions, these stem cells can be made to differentiate into any cells of choice. So using that, we are able to cure diseases like spinal cord injury, brain injury, which are otherwise non-repairable. So these are few of very important applications of annual cell culture which I have presented. So when you culture cells, the body, when you get cells out from the body, there are two types of cells primarily. Those cells which need a substratum to attach. So cells which need substratum and which can grow free. Grow free of substratum. Those cells which need a substratum to grow, they are referred to as adherent cells. They are referred to as adherent cells, whereas those which do not need any substratum to grow, they are referred to as suspensional cells. So this is basically the tendency of some cells, for example almost all cells barring the cells from the blood and the lymph, they are adherent, they need a substratum to get attached to, and after that they can proliferate. If they don't have a surface to attach, they do not proliferate and they die. Suspension cells on the other hand, they do not need any substratum to attach, they just be there, proliferate in the medium. As soon as the media is available, as soon as the space is available, they grow. Adherent cells do not proliferate until they are able to attach to the substratum. So for growing adherent cells, we need special tissue culture vessels, special tissue culture plasticware, which will be coated by certain chemicals which enable these cells to get adhered to that surface and proliferate. Suspension cells do not need any such tissue coated vessels, we can grow them in normal sterile plasticware. Talking about, now there is a term called subculturing. So subculturing refers to whenever a cell is grown in vitro, it is provided with all the optimum conditions, it is provided with the media, it is provided with the surface on which it will grow, it is provided optimum temperature, optimum pH, optimum gaseous requirement, the cell will start proliferating. After a given time, the space in the vessel will become limited, the media will get depleted. All these factors require the cells to be subcultured or passaged. The subculturing means you get the cells out from a vessel, put them into two or three different vessels, all containing fresh media, fresh surface for attachment. This enables to the cells to be in a state of proliferation over and over again. So if you do not subculture them or passage them, this leads to, in case of adherent cells, this leads to layering. Media will deplete, cells will come under stress, they will not be the same cells which you started with, they will have morphological defects, Whereas in case of suspension cells, the space is not the limiting factor as much as the media is. The media starts getting depleted as soon as the cell crosses a given number. So after that, you need to get the fresh media, and the cells should be subcultured. So subculturing involves, as in case of adherent cells, they are adhered to the substratum. We need to detach them from the substratum before they can be transferred into fresh vessels. In case of suspension cells, the cells are already detached. We just need to get the cells out, replace the media with the fresh media, lower the density of the cells in the vessel so that the cells can grow well in a new vessel. So this is about subculturing or passaging. Talking about advantages and disadvantages of animal cell culture, as I told you, advantage it is you can control the conditions in which you want to grow the cells. The cells are homogeneous in nature, and in case when you want to test the toxicity and the model system, you are required to submit only a small amount of molecule or small molecule or chemical in case of cell lines, as compared to the animal dose, in which you will be requiring more and more amounts of the chemical. So there are a lot of disadvantages also, because they are hard to maintain, specialized skill set, specialized plastic wear, specialized lab conditions, they are required. So you get only a small amount of tissue, only a small amount of cells at very high cost. Again, the cells growing in culture, they tend to de-differentiate, they tend to become they lose their homogeneity over the time, and they become instable cultures. So now coming to type of cell culture, as you are all aware about what is cell culture, what type of cells we have in culture, adherent as well as suspension, why we need cell culture for a lot of purposes like I have mentioned here. So when you start culturing the cells, what types of cell culture do you have? First of all, we have primary cultures. So primary cultures, so let's discuss first of all types of cell culture. So first of all, you have a primary cell culture. So primary cell culture involves you get the tissue out from an organism, treat the cells with various chemical treatments, and then grow them on a culture vessel. So getting the cells out of a tissue, dissociating the cells from multicellular state to unicellular uniformly suspended state, that involves use of chemicals, use of mechanical dissociation, and then it has a lot of advantages. The cells from a tissue will represent the tissue. You can directly use them for various purposes. Disadvantages is that initially the cells are homogeneous, but as we go on subculturing them, the cells lose their homogeneity and they become they tend to go into a fibroblast culture. So the preparation of a cell culture, a primary culture, is labor intensive. You need to sacrifice the animal, you need to get the tissue out, you need to mechanically dissociate or chemically dissociate the tissue. So again, the primary cell cultures, they are not forever. We need to get the cells every time, maybe 2 or 3 passages you can go at maximum. They tend to lose their ability to proliferate. So talking about second one is the continuous culture. So continuous culture is something which is generally carried out. Primary cell culture also has its importance. Continuous cell culture, usually you get the cells after passaging the primary cells. So when you have passaged the cells, the cell is said to be in continuous culture. It may last for 2, 3 passages, 10 passages. Whereas if you want to grow it even further, there are techniques which can convert continuous cell or cell lines to continuous cell lines. So continuous cultures, you have cell lines which can grow primary cells after they have been passaged. They are referred to as cell lines. They can grow for a maximum of 2, 3, 5, 10 passages, and then we have continuous cell lines. So the difference between the both lies in the fact that cell lines, normal cell lines or the simplest cell lines, they have finite lifespan. They tend to show senescence after 20 cycles of division. They are usually diploid, have certain degree of differentiation in them, and then it is essential to establish a system. So you, when you isolate these cells as primary cells, you passage them, these cells need to be stored in the early subcultured states so that you can again go back and get the early passage cells, because they will not keep on growing till 100 passages as the cancer cell lines or the other continuous cell lines. So the second is, so you have cell lines as I discussed, then you have continuous cell lines. So continuous cell lines are some things which will tend to grow. They can be propagated indefinitely. There is no senescence. They generally have this ability because of something called as transformation. Transformation is usually when cell do not stop dividing. It tends to go on dividing again and again and again, and it is a characteristic of cancer cells. So cancer cells, you can call these are transformed cells which do not obey the body. They go on dividing till they acquire, they almost span the whole body. So transformation you can introduce in your cells. These can be, again, the tumor cells which are isolated from the body, they will behave as continuous cell lines because they have the transformation, inbuilt transformation. You can introduce, we can introduce transformations using viral oncogenes. We can use chemical treatments for converting normal cell lines into cancer cell lines or transformed cell lines so that they can be propagated till infinity. So in one, I can show you this on this slide. So the culture involves getting tissue, then dispersing or dissociating or fragmenting this tissue and starting a primary culture. The cells obtained from the tissue directly grown on a vessel constitute the primary cell culture. After that, the primary cell culture can be subcultured. The subcultured, we can, after subculture, we can obtain a continuous culture which might either be a normal cell line or which will be a continuous cell line. Normal cell line, it will grow for a finite number of cycles, whereas continuous cell line, it will go on propagation infinite times. So this is a slide which we will be showing. So morphology of different cells. So what factors are responsible for growing cells in controlled conditions? What substances do you need to take into consideration when you grow cells in lab conditions, in controlled conditions? So there are factors which are very important with respect to growing cells in culture. First, so factors affecting cell culture. So factors affecting cell culture, first of and the foremost is the cell type. So cell type, cells should be appropriate. They should not be having any defect initially. Number two is the environment in which you want to grow. The environment includes, it includes the solid phase, which means the substratum you are providing to the cells for growth, or the plastic ware or the cell culture ware which is being used. It is very important because, as I told you, there are specific cells called adherent cells. They need substratum for growth. So if the substratum or the cell culture vessel is not proper, the cells will not grow. Then you have a liquid phase in which the cell will grow. That is referred to as cell media or cell medium. So the media should be optimum. It should be optimized as with respect to the type of cell being cultured. Different cells have different requirements for various different nutrients. So if we are able to provide different nutrients to different type of cells, they will grow properly. So the media consideration is again a very important aspect which affects the growth of a cell culture. Then you have the role of gaseous phase. Gaseous phase, again, the requirement of cells growing in vitro, again, the cells need an oxygen supply as well as CO2 supply. CO2 supply is usually 5% CO2, which helps in buffering. So these presence of these gases is very essential. A CO2 cylinder is always attached to an incubator which contains the animal cells growing, because it enables the buffering of the cell environment. Again, temperature. Temperature, again, it's very important aspect. So temperature of 37 degrees Celsius is a common temperature which is used, but different soils might have different requirements according to the type of the site from there where they have been extracted. And apart from the cell environment, we have something known as aseptic conditions. Contamination of these cultures by microbes present in air, water or any other presence on our hand. So we need to work, when we want to do cell culture, we need to work in an aseptic environment so that the cells can be grown uniformly. There is no contamination from outside sources. The contaminating substances usually tend to destroy your cell culture and you are not able to do experiments as per your will. So as I discuss, solid phase, very important, anchorage dependent cells, adherent cells, they usually need a substratum which is inert, which do not interfere in their growth, which is having proper coating of cell culture so that the cells can grow properly. Liquid phase, media is something which consists of salts, carbohydrate source, proteins, peptides, amino acids. For example, glucose as a carbohydrate source, as a carbon source, is very essential for most of our cells. Then you have different salts for maintaining the osmotic balance, and then proteins, amino acids, specific for specific cells, differ for different cells. Then you have trace elements, you have one thing which is added to the media is the serum. Serum is something, when you talk about serum, serum is undefined source. So serum from usually FBS, fetal bovine serum, FCS, fetal calf serum, these are used as an undefined source of nutrients added to the media so that whatever is missing in your basal media will be supplied from your serum. It contains a lot of proteins, a lot of ions, lot of salts which will enable the cells to grow properly. Serum is very important, and if you want to replace serum, if you want to get rid of a serum, there are specially designed medias commonly referred to as serum free medias. So if we move again into the gaseous phase, I told you there are specific incubators which are important. These incubators are fitted with carbon dioxide supply, they have fixed temperature, we can fix the temperature at a given value, and we have supply of an arrangement for supply of carbon dioxide. The cells keep inside, cells are placed inside, kept there for allowing them to proliferate. So gaseous phase and temperature. Temperature, as I told you, this is a figure which shows how cells are kept in an incubator, how you handle them, how you provide the particular temperature to them. Then aseptic condition, this is a figure which shows a laminar airflow or a biosafety cabinet in which a person sitting is doing his work. The cabinet provides aseptic conditions for persons to work inside. The cultures can be dealt with without any contamination, and it can be used for carrying out our cell culture purpose work. Now, there are, when you talk about biosafety regarding this, how, what sort of biosafety, there are three biosafety levels, because when you talk work in an animal cell culture lab, biosafety is of utmost importance. So there are biosafety levels BSL 1, 2 and 3. So BSL 1, and it is usually the biosafety level associated with bacterial culture, the culture which are not so pathogenic, although they might be associated with some human diseases. BSL 2, use of transformed cells, cancer cells, such cells which we use in the lab conditions, they require a BSL 2 safety level cabinet. And when you work in the case of diseases which are very infectious, Mycobacterium tuberculosis, very highly infectious, they make the use of a biosafety level 3 cabinets. So the difference lies in these, that equipment is different, we need to be more careful, we need to be having more precautions when you work in biosafety level 2 and 3 as compared to biosafety level 1. Although all these require use of aseptic conditions, properly autoclaving or properly sterilizing the equipment, properly sterilizing all the consumables which you are using in the cell culture lab. All these require that, but the level of precautions go up as you go into a biosafety level 1 to 3. For example, in case of biosafety level 3 setup, biosafety level 3 setup lab, you have different dresses for when you enter the lab, different headgear, different gloves. So everything is different. Nothing is to be taken out of the lab. Everything needs to be in the lab. Or everything should be sterile when you enter the lab. Everything should be having proper it should be sterile when you start working. So one more technique, the last technique which I am going to discuss with you is the cryopreservation of cell lines. So cryopreservation is basically the cells which you are growing, you want to save them for future use. So you save them at very low temperatures so as to maintain their structural integrity as well as their functional integrity also. So the cryopreservation in refers to storing cells at very low temperature, as low as minus 196 degrees Celsius. So you use temperatures very low as 196 degrees Celsius to store cells. This can be achieved by 3 or 4 methods. You have electric freezers, they go as down as minus 135. Then you have use of liquid nitrogen. Liquid nitrogen is the most common way how you store cells. Liquid nitrogen has a temperature of minus 196 degrees Celsius. You can store the cells at these temperatures, but to preserve the cells, you need the cells when they are going to be shifted to such low temperatures, they need to be added with something known as cryoprotectant, because otherwise if these substances are not added, the cell cytoplasm will tend to crystallize at these low temperatures and rupture the membranes, causing the cell to die. So you don't want your stored cells to be dead. When you revive them, they should be viable. So to maintain the viability, these need to be added cryoprotectants so that they can be recovered as viable cells whenever you want them in future. The most common cryoprotectants used are DMSO and glycerol. So glycerol and DMSO can be used as cryoprotectants in case of when you want to preserve the cells. So whenever you are working in a lab setup, you need to be aware of certain safety guidelines, safety aspects, safety considerations. So everything which you are working with in an animal cell culture, you have to consider it as infectious, you have to consider it as hazardous, you have to consider that this can cause you lot of problems if not handled properly. Then whatever you are pipetting, use of pipettes is of utmost importance. You should not use any pipette which involves sucking. There are proper pipette aids which can be used, which should be used rather, to provide any, to prevent ingesting anything. Then secondly, there should be the laminars, as you know, they have HEPA filters and they have exhausts also, so as to minimize the aerosol formation, if any. So there should be no eating, no drinking, no smoking inside a lab setup. Hands should be properly washed and sterilized before you leave a lab. The work surface on which you have been working, they should be decontaminated. They should be decontaminated using various agents like ethyl alcohol. All wastes, all cell culture where they should be autoclaved, so you have to prevent growth of any microorganism which might be left behind from your culture. Again, use of biological safety cabinet is a must for if you want to carry out animal cell culture lab. Aseptic techniques, the techniques which you follow, we should be aseptic. There should not be any instance of any chance of any contamination entering your culture, otherwise all your consumables, all your finances, they will be lost. Now liquid wastes are generally obtained in a cell culture lab, and spent media, there are other liquid wastes also. So all these should be properly dealt with, properly treated with bleach or whatever agent you have in your lab, so that these do not cause any problem. Liquid wastes are a major concern. They go into the sewerage system and can really cause a serious problem in the water supply and other. So this should be properly dealt with and disposed of properly. So this was about the animal cell culture, the various aspects of it, various types of it, why do we need it, regarding everything in a cell culture lab. A small topic I will be discussing, which is applied of cell culture, that is the stem cells. So stem cells as you know, stem cells, as you know, they are specialized cells. So stem cells, they are specialized cells from the body, differ from the other cells of the body in that they do not differentiate, they differentiate in all possible ways. They can differentiate in all cell types. They can differentiate in all cell types, plus they also self-renew. So stem cells are very unique. They are able to repair the injuries. They are present in the body as adult stem cells. They are able to repair the injuries wherever the site of the injury is. Stem cells, mostly when this research was started, they were extracted from embryos. They were extracted from embryos, the inner cell mass of the embryo. If you consider an embryo, this structure here, if you consider an embryo, this structure is inner cell mass. This is trophoblast. This is blastocyst. So from a blastocyst, you are able to get the cells of the inner cell mass and proliferate them and culture them, isolate them and culture them as stem cells. Now these stem cells, as I told you, they are very important in current medical scenario. They are this is the answer to various diseases which were earlier considered to be non-curable. So they differentiate into any cell type, they can self-regenerate. Then these cells are what we know as pluripotent, form the complete organism. So pluripotent cells, so stem cells are pluripotent cells, they can differentiate into any cell type and they can form and they can repair things. So this property is very important aspect. So as I told you, they are present, they are initially extracted from embryo, the inner cell mass, the cells of the inner cell mass are all pluripotent, referred to as embryonic stem cells, embryonic stem cells. Then you have something which is known as adult stem cells. Adult stem cells present in different tissues and they are responsible for treating or repairing the injuries in that very tissue. So they are adult stem cells or tissue stem cells. Nowadays we have something which is known as induced pluripotent stem cells. So this is an interesting category of stem cells which has been the studies have been going on till 2007. So adult stem cells used present in all the tissues used to repair that very tissue. Cells of the inner cell mass, embryonic stem cells, they are derived from the embryonic stem cells, if isolated can be used to treat various disease, but getting the cells out of the embryo is something which is considered unethical. Now when the things are unethical, it cannot be upscale, it cannot be used thoroughly. So to get something as an alternate for embryonic stem cells, a technique was started in which normal body cells were made to undergo changes and get converted into stem cells. That category is referred to as induced pluripotent stem cells. Induced pluripotent stem cells are normal somatic cells made to be stem cells. Normal somatic cells reprogrammed to get converted into stem cells, they are referred to as induced pluripotent stem cells. So how you can make stem cells from normal somatic cells? There are a lot of techniques. First and the foremost technique which was used was the use of transcription factors. So somatic cell converted to stem cell. The process refers to at reprogramming. How you can reprogram? Using transcription factors. So scientists were able to zero in on four transcription factors, OCT4, SOX2, KLF4, MYC, c-MYC. So these four transcription factors were basically used, and in normal somatic cells were reprogrammed into a stem cell like structure, although the efficiency of this conversion was only 0.02%. So only 2 out of 1000 cells were able to undergo this process. So this is very less as when we talk about cell cultures, but still this was the first ever time when it was reported that a normal cell can be converted into stem cells. Again, the factors used, these all transcription factors, 2 out of these, KLF and SYK, are oncogenes. Being oncogenes, these cannot be used. These can convert the cell into a cancer rather than converting it into a stem cell. So more and more research was carried out, and presently we have a technique in which we do not use any transcription factors. We use small molecules. So we use small molecules, chemical agents, to convert a normal somatic cell into stem cell. This technique is referred to as chemical reprogramming. So you can make an induced stem pluripotent stem cell by using transcription factors. You can use small molecules to get cells converted from a normal somatic state to a stem cell state and obtain the stem cells. So this all was aimed at providing an alternative to embryonic stem cells. Embryonic stem cells, because it is unethical to get the embryos from fetuses, it is against, because you do not know what the stage of the fetus, how is it going to be used. It is not ethical to get human embryos for research purpose. Going on further, already pluripotent stem cell. So you can use an already pluripotent stem cell and then use another somatic cell and then convert the somatic cell to pluripotent state. Those were the earlier cell techniques. Present are using transcription factors as well as using small molecules. So in the end, I'll just want to tell you the need. Why do we need it? Because embryonic stem cells, they pose an issue like ethical issues, the availability issues, again rejection issues are there. So it limits the use of embryonic stem cells, and we need an alternative. So alternative is provided by induced pluripotent stem cells, whether derived from various methods, most common being the chemical method. Again, the stem cells or induced pluripotent stem cells, the cells we have, they can be used for regenerative medicine. Means you are able to repair any tissue in the body using these cells. You can repair nerve tissues, you can repair heart muscles, you can repair liver tissues, pancreatic cells. So this finds application in patients suffering from diabetes, patients suffering from liver disorders, patients suffering from heart disorders, patients suffering from neural disorders. So all those, like Alzheimer's, diabetes, all these disorders find application of stem cells to be used potentially as a curable a substance which can cure these diseases. So this provides us a great insight into the animal cell culture and the role of stem cells in the current medical scenario. Thank you.